spoke to me and said to stay Friday as well, so I wasn't here Friday for the service, and Mark preached up. Probably Bossy led worship, it was good. And that was really good, so I didn't get to do like my part three of fresh anointing that I was going to do, so I'm going to do that next week. And I just felt like the Lord gave me a message. You know, I don't know if God's ever given you a word when you're this pregnant with something, with His word. And I literally feel like I just need to give birth this morning or something. That sounds weird. Whatever. Yes. Sorry about that. I literally feel like it's a fire shut up in my bones this morning. I just need to give you guys what the Lord has given me. And so I want to record it because I really feel like it's a word for our church as well. So I'm going to send it out. So Father, I want to thank you for this morning. Thank you for all these amazing people. And Lord, I just thank you for your grace. Help me communicate this morning, Lord, with clarity and with just conciseness, Lord, your word. That it would build up your people, that it would challenge your saints, that it would, that your word would do a work in all of us, myself included. And Holy Spirit, that you would speak through these lips of clay, the unsearchable riches of Christ. Help your church be built up and edified and strengthened and encouraged this morning. Lord, let the sword of your word come out and divide soul from spirit, bone from marrow. And let your word search us this morning. And help us to test ourselves to see whether we're really in the faith. And help us be intense like you call us to be. In Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. If you got your Bible, this message is called Transition. And I'm actually going to do a series called Transition. I think three series from now.
It's like Jesus.
In 2 weeks from now, not next week, I'm going to finish up part three of Fresh Anointing, and then I'm going to do a two-part series called God's Sexy Summer Love.
Yay!
And I'm going to, you know what, because God created sex, and He created romance, and He's into it. He is just so into all that He has made and all that He's created. So I'm going to teach on what I know about doing relationships God's way and how passionate He is about that. And then got some good stuff cooking after that. Going to start another series. Oh, God, just speaking to me. But transition. Mark 16. You guys there? Mark 16 and verse 14. Highlighted in orange in my Bible. Later He appeared to the 11, this is after Jesus' resurrection. He appeared to the 11 as He sat at the table, and He rebuked their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they did not believe those who had seen Him after He had risen. So Mary and some other women had seen Him, ran to the disciples, said, "Jesus is alive!" And they're like, "You're crazy. Crazy Jewish woman. What are you talking about? Jesus is alive. Get out of here," type thing. They didn't believe, and Jesus comes and he comes up on them and says, "I rebuke you. Why was your heart so hard? Why couldn't you just believe?" And so He sternly rebuked them because they had not believed in those who had seen Him after He'd risen. And He said to them, His disciples, "Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." That word condemned means damned. It's a condemnation. It's a sentence to hell. Those who believe will be saved. Those who refuse to believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who are super apostles and read their Bible 17 hours a day. Let's say that.
Wait, what?
These signs will follow those who are super apostles and read their Bible 17 hours a day. Oh, sorry. These signs will follow those who have a prophetic anointing on their life and have been saved 73 years. In my name, no. Oh,
keep going.
Oh, sorry, I see it. These signs will follow those who believe. We're going to say believe.
Believe.
These signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means, say by no means.
By no means.
It will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. The Holy Spirit spoke to me last night as I was falling asleep, and I already had this message, and this is the introduction. That this is the ministry of the believer. Jesus gives a synopsis of what we're called to do with faith, what we're called to do with the anointing and the power of God on our lives, no matter what our gifting is, no matter what our calling is. You may have an inclination, a passion to set up chairs or greet or be in charge of this ministry or that, or be a worship leader or whatever, be an evangelist or preach or lead a cell group or whatever. But we are all called to do the stuff. We all get to do the stuff.
Yeah.
And we're all called to do the stuff. These signs will follow those who believe. And in the Jewish word believe isn't just an intellectual consent. It's a faith and an intimacy that follows Jesus wholeheartedly. I love this revelation because it actually puts every person in here right in the battle. It puts you right in the game. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach to every creature." This is the goal of the gospel. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not believe will be condemned. These signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. Casting out demons is the ministry of a believer, according to Scripture. We all get to do it. And if you don't like casting out demons, try being tormented, or try being under oppression or depression for a little while, and then have a demon cast out of you, or have the oppression lift off of you, however you want to say it, and then tell me if you have the love of Christ in you that you don't want to help other people get free. This is what it means. It's not something spooky. It's not something kind of whatever. It is supernatural. People have demonic spirits, unbelievers. If someone's not a believer in Jesus Christ, they are, by default, under the dominion of darkness. They're under the dominion of demonic spirits. And they're trapped. They're controlled and manipulated by Satan, and they need help. So this is our call as believers to administer deliverance. It doesn't always have to look like people frothing at the mouth and barfing and stuff like that. That's, sometimes it can. Many times it doesn't. Many times it just looks like, you know, in an encounter day, we do a deliverance session or encounter weekend, we're going to continue to do deliverance sessions, and people go, and then it's gone. But people go, and then, you know, it comes through the airwaves. And I've even heard of people, like, pardon me, but farting. And a demon left someone, stuff like that. I mean, I don't know. I just know it comes through air passages, and sometimes, and God just delivers people, and He sets people free. I remember when I was 16 years old, and I was praying, and I'd just gotten saved, and I just learned how to pray in tongues, and shortly after that, but I was definitely meeting with God, and I was in my room, and I was praying, and I just supernaturally knew. I felt this heaviness, this weight on my chest, and I just knew I need to tell something to get off of me or out of me, so I started casting demonic spirits off of me or out of me, and I got on the floor and I was hacking for a couple minutes, and then it was gone. It was a freedom that came into my life, and I've never been the same since then. And since then, we all sometimes need deliverance, right? We pick up stuff in the world, we'll fall into some kind of temptation, and you know, if you let the enemy in, if you let him take an inch, sometimes he'll just pop the door right open and come in, type of thing. And that's what sin does. It invites the enemy. But anyway, we're all called to cast out demons. The ministry of the believer. Amen? You guys see this? These signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. Here's the reality. We are actually in a war. I'm going to talk about a vision that I had yesterday while I was driving into Sarnia. Everyone say actually.
Actually.
Okay, you're actually in a war. As a believer, it's the war in the spirit. It's the war of ideas that are floating around, people believing things. It's a moral war. You know, the church really is, the church of Jesus, is the moral compass or the moral standard for a generation. However holy the church is, the reason why, and see, the enemy is trying to steal this ministry from the believer. And he's tried to put it on those who are in full-time ministry, try to put it on the pastors and just the people. And oftentimes the pastors sometimes don't even walk in the reality of deliverance and casting out spirits. And so, you know, we've just kind of lowered the standard to just having nice services and a place where we can just kind of be comfortable and have a good, encouraging, life-enhancing message, which is actually can sometimes work against the gospel. Because sometimes your life is enhanced when you die to yourself and deny your flesh and suffer a little bit and, you know, go through a fiery trial or something like that. It's not always, you know, 10 steps to a better you, although I'm not against any of that stuff, if that's what the Lord's laid on our heart. But what I'm saying is there's a war. And many of us, we've learned how to sing Kumbaya in the battle and just kind of go, I believe in peace and not war. And then we get taken out. And life just, you know, goes awry for us or whatever, because we neglect the reality that there is a spiritual battle. And we're in the war. We're fully engaged in this battle with this present darkness to the point where you as a believer, not just pastors, not just super apostles, not just people that are in full-time ministry, we don't only get to cast out demons, we are commanded. In my name, those who believe, they will cast out demons. Driving out darkness. Driving back darkness through intercession, through prayer, through seeking God. Every believer, not only super apostles or church leaders only, but every believer fully engaged in the war. We've managed to not fully engage in the war. And then we wonder, where's all the fruit? Where's the people getting delivered and where's the salvations? God's calling us to fully engage in the war and make this, believe that this is your ministry. It's a war between the saints and Satan's hordes. I don't know how to say it in a nicer way. It's just the reality. We're going to read the scripture in a minute. Second thing they will do with cast out demons, they will speak with new tongues. Ministry of the believer. Now, can you be a believer and be saved and not speak in tongues? Absolutely. Absolutely, you can be. But my question is, if Jesus himself says, in my, these signs will follow those who believe, they will cast out demons, they will speak with new tongues, what it speaks to me, very clearly, is that it's available. And as all things in the kingdom and as all things in the spirit, it's according to our faith. If we've been taught, the gift of tongues is passed, and we've received that teaching, I've noticed it can be very difficult for people later on in life to receive the gift of tongues because they've already believed something prior. So there's a huge mind shift that has to happen for them actually to believe that they can speak in tongues and the reality that speaking in tongues isn't just for kind of some crazy Pentecostal charismatic vineyard, you know, dunamis people or something like that, or just the Pentecostals over in that corner, that, you know, that they will speak in tongues. Believers will speak in tongues. They can. It's available. Hallelujah. To all believers. How I know that so securely is not just from this scripture, but every evidence, every time the Holy Spirit is poured out in scripture, every time people are baptized in the Holy Spirit, and God makes it clear in Acts chapter 1 that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is for every believer. Every time people are baptized in the Holy Spirit, they immediately speak in tongues. Sometimes they speak in tongues and prophesy. Yeah. Actually, in fact, most times in the Bible, they speak in tongues and prophesy. I don't think there's one indication in scripture, correct me if I'm wrong, where someone gets baptized in the Holy Spirit and they do not speak in tongues. Okay. Can you be saved and not baptized in the Holy Spirit? I think absolutely. You can be saved, receive Jesus as your Savior, and still not receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Many Pentecostals are saved, baptized in the Holy Spirit, speak in tongues, but they still don't have a revelation of the Father's love. We serve a triune God. We can know Jesus and the Holy Spirit and not have a revelation of the Father. And why not have it all? Yeah. Why not have Jesus as your Savior? Mm-hmm. Sometimes people can just have Jesus as their Savior and still not have the Holy Spirit, but they can have a revelation of the Father intellectually, and they can have a lot of wisdom. I know a lot of people that are just amazing believers, amazing people that do not have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And they're missing an aspect of the power of God. They believe it, so they love Jesus. Absolutely. What I'm saying is, why not have it all? Why not have Jesus, have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, speak in tongues, pursue all the gifts, prophecy, word of knowledge, do everything, and have a revelation of the Father's love and the fear of the Lord, and just keep growing and growing and growing. It's unlimited, right? You can keep growing in that. But anyway, they will speak with new tongues. And I'm going to park on that for a second. There's some people in here who need a revelation of the Father's love. There's some people in here who need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So wherever you are, you know, all of you here, if you're saved, you have Jesus. That's where it starts. He is the access point to God in his fullness. And so pursue the fullness of God. They will speak with new tongues. So I believe God's equipping his army to pray with supernatural accuracy and strength. That's what happens when I go into the Spirit and I say, Shaka Rabanda Se Riba Seke. I'm not preaching right now, I'm just demonstrating. I feel the Holy Spirit as I pray in the Spirit, and there's a supernatural strength and edification that comes into me, and I'm built up, and I feel His presence, and I feel His power, and I feel His love. I believe tongues can also be used as a form of intercession. You're praying, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, that we, as we pray in tongues, we pray mysteries into the Spirit. Also, we can pray in tongues and we can interpret our own tongues for our own edification. There's a whole realm of the Holy Spirit that's opened up to us. Listen, if we're going to fight demonic hordes, we need the power of the Holy Spirit with speaking in tongues and prophesying and using every gift that that God gives us. Praying in tongues is powerful. One of the most powerful things we can do is pray in tongues or pray in the Spirit of God. And I want to encourage every person here to pursue that. Ask God for it. Seek it. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 14, eagerly desire spiritual gifts.
Hallelujah.
Not a suggestion. Paul's commanding his church, be hungry. Be hungry for the fullness of God. You know, do you have to have it? No, but why wouldn't you want it?
Yeah.
You want everything that God gives you, every gift that he has for you. Speaking in tongues is a gift that you can have if you want it. Can there be those who are baptized in the Holy Spirit and don't speak in tongues? I think so. I believe so. If they have a predisposition that it's not of God, they can have the baptism of the Holy Spirit perhaps and prophesy and have, you know, I don't know if I've ever seen it very much, so I'm not saying for sure, but whatever. That's up to debate. Some things like, you know, for Dunamis Church, I want to like preach the gospel and go for it, but I don't want to hold anyone to some sort of theological disposition for sure, because we're all still learning and growing,
mm-hmm.
right? We're all still seeking understanding. And so more than I want to teach people what to think, you know, we need to learn how to think for ourselves and how to have a relationship with God that isn't, you know, vicariously based on Pastor Josh or your leader or something like that. It's you and Jesus having a relationship. Your relationship with God, with Jesus, isn't through me. My job is just to preach the word, give you what God's given me, edify. We're all edifying each other. Amen?
Hallelujah.
They'll speak in new tongues. They will take up serpents. Now, I don't have any experience with this. Well, actually, I do. You guys have seen my Facebook picture. But he actually, you guys seen that Facebook picture?
I can look at it right now.
Okay, don't worry about it. I was at my cottage, really quick story, I gotta move quick. I was at my cottage and I was searching for bullfrogs, just because like that little boy comes out. Once a year I have to do it, and I've been doing it since I was like born. There's this, we call it the frog land or whatever, and at the end of my day, and there's a lot of bullfrogs and frogs, and catch tadpoles, and they like, you know, search up, and there's all these little bugs and stuff like that. It's just a boy's dream, right? I'm 29, but I still love it. And once a year. Winston, if you ever come to my cottage, we'll go bullfrog hunting, brother. If you want. But anyway, I was in Frogland, and I seen the biggest snake I've ever seen in my life. I didn't know how big it was exactly, but it was huge. And I'm like building up my courage. I'm like, I want to, but I don't. I want to, but I don't. I'm like, if I don't, I'm gonna regret it. This is like the opportunity of a lifetime for me. I'm gonna catch this huge snake. Bill, have you seen these pictures?
I think so.
There's a hop on my Facebook sometime, man. Chapman's words, I'm the man. And so I grab this snake by its tail, and I have it by its tail, and literally, it's probably a meter long.
Nice.
Like, this snake is from here all the way here.
That's longer than a meter.
I don't know. It's probably longer than, it's big. Just look at the pictures. So I have it by, and then I grab its head, turn it around, bit me. That was awesome. And it wasn't poisonous.
Was awesome.
Well, all snakes are poisonous, but anyway. I took up the snake, but that's not what this is talking about. That's just a story. This literally means we have supernatural ability over poisonous snakes that they can't hurt us. Because in this land, when Jesus was calling people to go out and preach, it's like there's dangers. Like, what if a snake bites me? I'm going off into this kind of weird island. I'm trying to preach to these people, and they speak my language, and I gotta like learn their language, and you know, I don't know anything about the terrain, and I don't know anything about the territory and the land, and what if like, and Jesus is like, hey, you'll be able to take up serpents, and they won't harm you.
Yeah.
And it's going to be so supernatural, the power that you walk in, as you're casting out demons and speaking in tongues and just going for it, preaching the gospel. If you drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt you. What an awesome promise from God. You know, this doesn't mean I go and like, hey, let's test this theory, you know, and like drink something poisonous. And no, it's talking about an accident or someone tries to poison you or you drink something poisonous. You've done that,
yeah,
and you've lived to tell about it.
I didn't have no effects.
They will lay hands, so not even poison. People poisoning us or drinking poisonous stuff accidentally will hurt us. That's awesome. It's basically saying, like, you are a supernatural, like, God-man in Jesus Christ. I don't know if that's exactly what it's saying. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying, like, you're God. I'm saying there's a supernatural strength that's in you and a supernatural protection. Which is awesome, which takes the fear out of it, you know? God's like, your life is Father-filtered, and if you go forward in my... What does Father-filtered mean? It just means if you're in God's will... Only if God lets it happen will it happen. When you step out of God's will, under his, out of his canopy of protection, then the enemy can get you. But if you're in his will, with supernatural protection, they will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Every believer called to demonstrate the goodness and power of God with miracles as we lay hands on the sick and pray for them. Laying hands on the sick and seeing people get healed is not the ministry of just those who have the gift of healing. It's the ministry of anybody who is in Christ.
Yeah.
Awesome, isn't it?
Yeah.
You get to do the stuff.
Yeah.
Not just for super Christians. It's for anybody who has the grace of God.
Yeah.
Anybody who's responded to Jesus and just said, you know what, Lord, let me grow. I want to grow in you, and I want to learn to do this stuff. Everyone say learn.
Learn.
Okay. After the Lord spoken to me, he was received up into heaven, sat down at the right hand of God. Awesome. And they went and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word through the accompanying signs. Amen. What I sense that the transition is, and I'm going to get right into the message now. Introduction. What I sense that the transition is, it's only 11:30, we have lots of time.
Yeah, freaking.
Is that God is wanting to transition many of us, Dunamis Church as a whole, into a place of faith. Many of us are not living the victorious Christian life. We're not pressing into all what God has for us. There's a scripture in 1 John 5, and I just felt like the Lord highlight this verse to me. 1 John 5, you know what, I'll just read verse 4. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. So if you're really born again, you're going to overcome the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world. Your faith. So how do you get victory? Faith. A life of faith will equal a life of victory on every level. You need victory in your life, in any area, we need faith.
Yes.
I was driving into Sarnia, and I think it was like Arcona, and I just had this vision, and I knew it was God. I believe it's God. I'm driving in, and maybe in Arcona Forest area last night, and I see in my spirit... A huge demonic spirit, like a principality, like, I don't know, hundreds or thousands of feet high, over Sarnia, with its hand on Sarnia. And this principality, and I'll give scriptural context to this in a minute, this principality, this governing demonic spirit was saying, mine. And what I was feeling was, it was saying, Sarnia is mine. And you know what? We see that. Over Lambton County, we see the results of it. We've had up to almost 20 suicides just this year so far in this region. I don't want to sound kind of ominous or just drastic in some kind of way. I don't want to be the prognosticator of doom. I'm not doing that. I'm just saying what God showed me. That there is a real, that I feel like there's an oppression that God wants to break off this city. That's why he showed me that. There's something, and sometimes you feel it. You drive into a geographical location, you fly somewhere, and just the atmosphere just changes, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes I've come into Sarnia, and there has been a heaviness. I remember when I grew up in Oshawa, and I was going to two Pentecostal churches in town. I was like, God was moving in my life. He was doing stuff. I came to Sarnia, and it just shut down when I was 17. It literally just, I couldn't meet with God anymore in my bed. Like, it was sticky. You know what I mean? The atmosphere was changed. The atmosphere was different in Sarnia than it was in Oshawa. And I didn't have, obviously, the support around me and stuff like that. But there is an atmosphere. And God wants to change it. I said, oh God, what are we going to do about this? There's this demon, this principality. And just to give a little bit of context, and I'll just read this. I think it will be the last scripture I read this morning. Ephesians chapter 6.
Yes,
verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able. Okay, the armor of God enables us. Like, without it, God's like, you're pretty done. You're toast. Put on the armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles, or it means the schemings of the devil. Everyone say schemings.
Schemings.
Okay, the devil is a schemer. He'll do whatever he can to interrupt, to interfere with our relationship with God. He'll try to put a relationship within there. He'll attack us with doubt. He'll attack us with fear. There's different stuff. And God says, stand firm, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles or the schemings of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Okay, it's not a battle with people. It's not a battle with your crazy mother-in-law or whatever. It's not a battle with your neighbor. It's a battle in the realm of the spirit. And it's a war in the spirit. It's a spirit war. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. But listen, against principalities. Against powers. Against the rulers of the darkness of this age. Or against, another version will say, this darkness. Against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. It's principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of the age, spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. It starts listing the armor of God. What Paul reveals to us is that there are, like, rankings. There's some spirits, demonic spirits, that are more powerful than others. There's what the Bible calls, there's foot soldiers, spiritual hosts of wickedness. Hosts. A host is many. I don't know how many a host is, but it sounds like lots. Spiritual hosts of wickedness. Then there's powers. Oh, sorry, then there's rulers of the darkness of this age. Over that is powers. And over that is principalities. Now, do I really know what this means? Not really, but I know it. It's talking about rank. It's talking about understanding the schemings of the devil. Now, I don't talk about the devil that much, but I will in the Holy Spirit, because we don't glorify Satan. We glorify God. He is so much more powerful. We're all safe. We're in the kingdom. But there's a generation out there that's in the darkness. So the topic at hand is, how do you get them out of the fire of hell? How do you get them out of the darkness and into the light? How do you get them into the kingdom?
Yeah.
That's the question, isn't it? Lord, what are we called to do? What do we do to come against this principality? So I'm looking at this last night, and I say, Lord, what do we do? And then I see two angels, one on the left, one on the right, comparable in size. I don't know whether they were archangels. Lord never spoke to me about it. But they were angels. They were huge. And I'm like, what? God, we're twice as big. You know, scripturally, we're actually three times as big. That's a different story, just in the realm of how many angels there are compared to demons. But God, there's two angels. What's going on? And I'm like, how do we activate these angels? And God was like, it's through the church. As the church acts, half of those who wait for me. You know, the psalmist said, David said, the Lord acts on behalf of those who wait for him. as we go, Paul said, or Jesus said, sorry, go. Everyone say go.
Go.
Go. You gotta go. You gotta do something. Jesus said, pray. The Lord of the harvest would send out laborers into his harvest. And one of the issues is, we're comfortable. We can get comfortable, and life gets squishy. And I'm not against comfort and squishiness, you know what I mean? It's part of our inheritance. I mean, for God's sakes, we live in Canada. And I don't mean to be sacrilegious in saying that. I'm just saying, it's a fact. We live in Canada, we're squishy, we're wealthy. We're one of the most wealthy countries in the world. And we just get comfortable, and we get our eyes off the battle sometimes. And we get our eyes onto me and mine, and kind of this 20-foot radius of me and my life and what's going on with me, and we forget about all the lost, and we forget about to listen to God and God, what's up? You know, we cry out to him when there's a trial, but when everything's good, we're like, no, it's all good. And we stop pressing in. Notice that you do that. When you have a trial, you're like, God, help! And then when everything's good, you're like, coast. Until the next trial, God, help! Everything's good, coast. And it always helps us. The key is, when things are good, keep your eye on the battle. Because then you can go from glory to glory. This is the point. When I'm talking about transition in some months to come, we're going to talk about actually going from glory to glory, what that means, what our inheritance is as the church. Not just to occupy some space. God wants us to occupy the kingdom of darkness. He wants us to take ground. He wants us to possess the land. The Israelites possessing the land is an Old Testament type and shadow of what we do in the New Testament, and that is to take the land. It's to occupy. It's to aggressively advance. To get something in your spirit that says, the devil is not going to take my city, he's not going to take my generation, I'm going to advance. So how do we do that? Let's get practical. What's the solution? How do we activate heaven and activate these angels? Guys, there's really three things. And I think I'm going to be done in a moment. I was going to get all up in this whiteboard, maybe I will. For the sake of Randy, I picked these guys up this morning. My whiteboard's in the back and they had to like squish in the little corner. So I'm going to try to use it even if it's small. Here's what we do. Number one is prayer. This is how simple it is. You want to activate heaven? Pray. Develop a prayer life. I'm not talking about saying your prayers 5 minutes before bed. All good. I'm totally for that. Great. One thing my mom and dad gave me growing up, and bless their hearts, is they prayed with me every night before bed. Every night before bed. I had to repeat it. Lord Jesus. I'll just say the prayer and I had to repeat it. Lord Jesus, thank you for a good night's rest. Thank you for a good sleep, good thoughts, good dreams. Lord, thank you for your guardian angels. Thank you for your guardian angels all around me. And something else. I love you, Jesus. Amen. Every night. And then we get to do one worship song and one fun song. Every night. My dad would do that with me. It's powerful. I'm all for that. But a prayer life where you're cultivating intimacy with God, and out of that intimacy, you know, intercession is intimacy. Sometimes warfare is in any time you engage heaven, anytime you're advancing. I like soaking. Soaking is great, soaking intimacy with God. But I've learned it's all intimacy. When God tells me to evangelize to someone, that's intimacy. It's just doing his will. You love Jesus by loving people too, right? So it's all God. It's all good. There's lots of ways we pray. There's lots of methodologies. We pray in tongues. I can pray in English or pray in Chinese, or I can intercede. I can wave a flag. I can worship to words. I can play my guitar. Whatever. It's all good. Just seeking God. That's a prayer life. And morning prayer and intercession and group thing. It's all good. Number two is this. Is evangelism. Now, here's where a lot of believers get stuck. Now, there's many different ways to evangelize. And sometimes we look for the most comfortable one. And that's okay when you're, you know, it's just like, I'll just hand you a card or I just do stuff. We're all called to reach out. But reaching out will come out of a place of prayer. We'll come out of a place of intimacy with God. The third thing is discipleship. And what is that? that's helping one another along. And that is, that's mentoring people. You come to a place where you're not just being discipled, but you're mentoring and you're discipling others. And so it's these three things for Dunamis Church in the progression, or for the progression of the vision. So I just want to write that out. It's prayer.
It's pie.
Nice.
Prayer,
yeah,
is the P.
Evangelism.
No, intercession is the
prayer.
I.
Intercession is part of prayer. Sorry.
Sorry. No problem.
You almost added a pie. Intercession is the P. It's part of prayer, but the reality is that prayer is so multifaceted. I'm not gonna say, like, you know what prayer is? Prayer is worship. Worship is part of prayer. Prayer is just connecting with God, you and God. You and Jesus, you're connecting, you're loving him, he's loving you. It's good, you're building that relationship. Evangelism is the go of the gospel. That's where we go out and we take our relationship with God and we give it away to somebody. And the cool thing about that is there's a difference between God's presence in you and God's presence on you. God's presence is in you when you worship and he comes on you and it's just an awesome thing. But when God puts his power on you, he gives his power for ministry. So that's what I preach out of every Friday, every Sunday. That's what I attempt to preach out of, is God's anointing, his presence resting on me, his word that's in me, and it's like a fire shut up in my bones, and I gotta give that away. That's why, if you like listening to me preach, that's why you like listening to me preach, not because I'm some kind of great orator or something like that, it's because God's presence. His presence in me, his presence on me. That's what's gonna make the deal for you. When you walk up to somebody, or when you invite your sister out, or however God leads you to evangelize, whatever you become willing to do, but I'm telling you, everyone in here, and this is what stops a lot of people in the progression. If we're called to, like, progress as a church, we're called to go forward with a forward momentum, we're called to take ground, what stops a lot of believers is unwillingness. I was reminded on my vacation, when we were kind of a prayer retreat, the only thing that stopped me, and the only thing that could continue to stop me, is my unwillingness. One of the great evangelists, Evan Roberts, who led the Welsh revival, his cry as a 25-year-old before he led this revival was, God, bend me. He cried it out, God, bend me. What's he saying? He's saying, get this fear out of my life, get my will out of the way, and do with me what you want to do. And that's the journey that we're on. And so this, you know, many believers, they develop a prayer life, but because there's no release, you know, Jeff Dale, worship leader, said it this way. He said, it's one thing to get the Holy Spirit in you. It's another thing trying to get the Holy Spirit out of believers. You know, it's one thing to get him in you, but we need to get him out of us. Because his presence, the anointing, the Bible says, destroys the yoke. It's his presence. It's not, you know, well, if they want to come to church, then God would draw them. No, he says, go. So whatever he says to you, just do it. It's obedience. And obedience and faithfulness perpetuates obedience and faithfulness. You know, I went and picked up Carly yesterday.
Aww.
And I picked up Carly. I went to visit Carly at Boston Pizza. She was working a late shift. And I felt like the Lord was like, invite her boss out. I'm like, hey, what's his name again?
Wade.
Wade, right. And I'm like, hey, you should come to church sometime on a Sunday morning. He's like, oh, haha, yeah. And then he kind of was like, he'll probably come one day. And I just invited him out. And I was like, okay, that's cool. So I was walking out, and there was a couple guys from India, a Sikh guy and a Hindu guy. And I just felt in my heart, hey, let's just talk to them for a minute. So I did. God's presence was there. I'm like, oh, cool. Was listening to them, it was really good. And then I'm like, we were about to leave. I gave them the church card. They kind of like, oh, thanks for the church card. And then I'm like, does anyone have any pain in their body at all? And the guy's like, well, my back. He's like, what happened? He found out he was in the hospital for 8 months, had gotten a car accident like, I don't know, 10, 15 years earlier. Was in constant pain. He's like, thank God, I've learned to live with it. And I'm like, well, think one of the reasons like I'm here is because I'm supposed to pray for you right now. God's going to touch you. You ready? He's like, touch totally open. Take his hand. Pray for him. Totally healed.
Wow. That's good.
He takes out the church card and he's like, so when's this church again? Owns a couple gas stations in town and just kind of a, you know, Indian businessman. Sarnia. Who is Sikh. Jesus healed his back. Because it's a sign of the believer. It doesn't happen because I'm a pastor. It doesn't happen because of anything special about me. It happens because I'm just willing to take the time and let God move through my life. Is it sacrifice? Yeah. I could be doing lots of things. I could be watching a movie. I could be hanging out with friends. I could be playing euchre. I could be whatever, at a bar. But I'm not. I chose to be there in that moment. God touched his life. I was driving to River City, saw three more kids. Felt preached to them too. And it hasn't happened in a while. Like, okay, I feel like this season is coming back of just evangelism and aggressiveness coming back. I gotta finish. Stopped and talked to them, and God's presence was so there. Two of them had 16, 17-year-old kids, from young men, from Skits, if you're watching this, from Skits, and God healed their backs too,
wow.
One after another. And they were so, they're like, well, we'll probably see you at youth on Tuesday, we'll see their Tuesday night. They're like thinking about coming out. Because God builds his church in power. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, the kingdom of God is not in word, it's in power. It's not just preaching. It is. It's in power. It's evangelism. When you're there and you start getting filled with God's presence and then you start giving it out, guess what happens inevitably? Somebody comes out of darkness and they come into the kingdom and now there's two. And then there was two. That's what happened to me. I came back and I was already preaching and winning souls. I came back to Sarnia when I was 20. And I connected with this guy, Derek, who's a believer, never felt the presence of God before. We started pressing in. I started teaching him how to pray. He felt the presence of God, you know, and then there was two, and then we were praying for my younger brother, then Ben got saved, and then my boss, John Day, got saved, and this other kid, Jordan, got saved, and then there was five of us, and we just kept growing, and that's how the church started. It was just me, and then one guy, and another guy, and another guy, and another guy. So, you know, God draws different people, and he's doing a work. But this is what happens to all of us, is we're all called to make disciples. So what happens is, when somebody comes into the kingdom, that's where discipleship comes in. And you start mentoring and pouring in knowledge and understanding and start hanging out with that person and loving on them and helping them through issues and all that kind of good stuff. And as we're all doing that, this is how all people in the church can get pastored. When we're all pastors. The purpose of a pastor is to raise up the whole church to be pastoral. Yeah, the purpose of an apostle, the Bible says God gives gifts to the church. He gives apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints so the saints can do ministry.
Yeah.
So everyone in here, everyone watching, if you're a believer, you're in full-time ministry. Just say, I am a full-time minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. What's a minister? A minister is a servant. Ministry is serving. So you're a full-time servant serving people the good news of Jesus. We all are. Sunday mornings is for equipping so we can go out and do the stuff. And the yoke is easy and the burden is light. Because we don't run around like chickens with our head cut off. We just say, God, I just want to fall in love with you. And whatever you put in my heart, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be led by your spirit. I'm not going to try to do things for you. I'm not going to try to do anything. I'm just going to try to obey you when you speak to me. Amen? This is where it comes from. This is true kingdom works. So all this is for the purpose of the vision. And, you know, my pastor, God already spoke to me when I was 19 years old, and there was a conference that came at the School of Ministry. It was called Multiplication to Win a City, and I heard about a youth ministry of 20,000, young people, and I was like, my God, how do you have a youth ministry of 20,000 people? And this minister from England, this guy Ken Gott, described this youth ministry as an army, and when they get up to pray, they're just praying with all their passion, and 20,000 young people praying, and I'm like, my God, I want to see that in Canada. Mm-hmm. I will see this in my nation. I will see an army rise up. How do you do this? And he started talking about a vision that they were doing in Bogota, Colombia, called the G12 vision. And basically what it was a system or a vision, a strategy, if you will, that a man received from heaven, that God has called churches, that really thousands of churches, I believe, all over the world to do this vision. Actually gave it to the biggest church in Europe. This man, Sunday at Elijah, received the G12 vision separately from this guy, Cesar Castellanos. This church is like 20 or 30,000 people in Kiev, Ukraine. This Nigerian guy, Sunday at Elijah, comes to a totally white, racist, you know, country and starts a church and raises up a ministry of over 20,000. All these Ukrainians getting saved, coming out of dead religion, coming into faith in Jesus. It's awesome. He first came to Russia, and they used to say to him, like, who cut off your tail, monkey? Just racist Russia. And he'd go up and he'd give them a hug. And he'd say, well, have you ever been hugged by a monkey? And they'd laugh. And his heart was, well, at least I get to make them laugh.
Yeah.
Like, he was so humble. He was so pliable in God's hand. And, you know, other you know, black men or whatever, or, you know, would rage out, and fight, and bicker. And he's just, God had gotten a hold of his life. And God sent him to Ukraine. And some Nigerian guy who got brought over by communists to Russia to be raised as a communist, but he got saved before that through televangelist, went to Russia, got trained up as a journalist in TV, went to the Ukraine, started a TV program. God called him to start a church, and now he's taking a nation. You got to look at some Sunday at Elijah, Kiev, Ukraine. Check him out. Awesome. G12 vision, we're going to talk about. Before I just mention that quickly, we got 5 minutes left. You guys getting something this morning?
Yes.
Before I mention that, I just want to say quickly about just what I feel like just some stuff needs to change, like in the ministry. I was driving home, and I was like, God, what do we need to do? What do we need to change? And so here's what we're gonna try. You guys ready for this? Greg and John, you're gonna love this. You too, James. I want to do prayer from 7 to 8 instead of 8 to 9. Change it back to 7 to 8. Here's why. We do prayer every morning from 8 to 9, and people say to me, well, I can't come because I work at 8:30 or something. I'm like, fair enough, you got to work. So, you know, in Bogota, oh, you're going to love that too, Dave. All right. Prayer 7 to 8.
I have school at 8:50.
Oh, perfect. Prayer 7 to 8. Oh my gosh, yes. Here's, you know, in Bogota, when the church, I think it was like 2 or 3,000, I think they did two prayer meetings. I think they did one from like, I don't know, 5:30 to 6:30, and then one 6:30 to 7:30 or something like that. And thousands of people coming to morning prayer. Moms coming with their baby nursing on their breast, walking to prayer. It was so hardcore. Prayer, I'm telling you, corporate prayer releases power. Okay, so we're going to change that. And then, so I need just more office time. I need to work. I need to write manuals. God's put all this stuff in my heart to create and just prepare. Preparations, well, because we are going to be a church. I just wanted to let you guys know, in case you didn't. I know that a lot of you guys are here by faith this morning. God's calling us to be a church of tens of thousands of people in this city. For real. You guys believe that? There's and God's calling us, all of us, to rise up. If you're saying, well, I'm all afraid, and I'm insecure, and I've got all these issues, perfect! God can use you. Yep. If that's where you are, he says, you're weak, guess what, baby? I am strong.
Yeah.
You're insecure? I'm totally secure, God says, in myself. And I'll be your security. You need a security blanket? Jesus. He's the greatest security blanket ever. Morning prayer. And, you know, work from 8 to 12, lunch. What I felt is 3 days a week, we're going to try this for the next couple months, from 2 to 4 p.m., Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, I'm going to focus in on evangelism and raising up people who want to go preach. So if anybody here says, you know what, I really want to hit the streets, let's get out there, let's win some people to Christ, 2 to 4, just let me know. Like, we'll have to arrange it. It's not going to be like, you know, we'll pray, we'll maybe talk a little bit, we'll go out for an hour, hour and a half. And from 2 to 4, 6 hours a week, we're going to spend on training and evangelism. I want to raise up some preachers. You know where you learn how to preach? You get into the desert. Just like John the Baptist. He learned how to preach in the desert. You don't learn how to preach in the church. We're all saved. There's no need in your light shines, but not your. You learn how to preach when you go into the dark and you take your little candle and you start shining on people.
Yeah.
And you'll learn. Trust me, you'll learn the anointing. You'll learn how to flow in the presence of God and speak to people as you learn how to speak to the lost. Trust, when I first started preaching, I sucked. Walk with people, I'm all scared, kind of mumbling out something. They're like, what'd you say? I'm like, it was ridiculous how scared I was. You know, but God, one moment at a time, God trained me. I kept pushing. I kept going. I kept going back to the drawing board. Lord, how do I reach people? And I kept praying, and I kept pressing in. And guess what? That's how it is. But as we flow, we're going to raise up a generation that preaches the gospel. Not because we're all insecure and we're trying to work our way to heaven, but because we're so in love with Jesus that we're just flowing out. Part of my job is just to say, break that fear off you. You know you want to. It's like we're filled with God and we're like, we want to step out, but it's scary. So we'll learn to break through, and I want to help some of you guys, whoever wants to. How do I break through? Well, let's go break through together. And once you see it done, you might be more confident. Yeah, I remember very clearly some of Carly's journey. You know, Carly's been in the church for eons. And, you know, I remember one time with Carla, you know, she was trying to break through into singing. She never sang in front of anyone. And God spoke to me and said, let's go to this big rock in front of St. Clair, and she's going to stand on it. Sing. Oh.
You didn't even know there was a rock there. I was going to St. Clair, and you're like, let's go to St. Clair, and then we just found a rock, and we're like, this is perfect.
Yeah, so she's still in the rock. Anyway, yeah, that big rock.
Oh, that rock?
She broke through, and it was like breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough, and, you know, God even told Carly to stand up on her cafeteria table and drop a word one time. It was scary. You know how scary that is? She did it. And she told me after, she phoned me, she was so excited, she goes, I feel like I have Goliath's head in my hand.
That's awesome.
She was walking around her school with a head. She was different, something trans, you know.
And then like something, like after that, like Mike did it, and Carly did it, and Jesse did
it. It was just a chain reaction.
Yeah.
The Lord spoke to me a word actually before he said any of this to me, and he said, obedience perpetuates obedience in others. Billy Graham said when someone stands up and is courageous, the spines of other men stiffen, or something like that. Like, courage begets courage. Faith begets faith. Obedience begets obedience. When we step out in faith, there is a release. Something happens. You know? And I believe God did that because I believe God's got a ministry for Carly. And in fact, I know that. And he was challenging her. Do you want to be, are you willing to lose your life? Are you willing to step out in courage in the midst of fear, in the midst of insecurity, and there's all these issues inside, and the devil's attacking from out, fears are attacking within, but God is speaking, and something happens when we step out in obedience. Amen?
Yeah.
And it's nothing to do with striving, it's just to do with obeying Jesus. Obeying God. So that's what we're going to do. And we're going to build this vision. We're going to build teams of 12. We're going to build the ministry. And this is how it's going to happen. Now, there's lots more we could talk about, but it's 12 o'clock, so. You guys good?
Yes.
This is what I felt in my spirit to talk about today.
Yeah.
I believe, lastly, I just want to say this, that the Lord desires for each of us, personally, in our lives, to grow in Him every day. Take some steps forward each day. You know, if you go to the gym and you want to get, like, ripped, it doesn't happen in a day, and it doesn't happen in a week. It happens over months and months of repetition, of training, reps, training, eating the right food, exercise, reps, training, eating the right food, increasing the weight, doing more than you can, pushing yourself to the next limit, right? And over time, no one loses 50 pounds in a day. Healthily, it will happen over time. And this is that God wants us to grow every day in Him. And also, lastly, He desires this church to grow.
Yeah.
I love what God's doing Tuesday nights when He's just blasting us. I love what He's doing on Fridays, and I'm saying more, Lord. And I love what He's doing on Sunday mornings. I'm telling you, He wants to move through us, even this week. He wants us to be bigger and stronger. When we come back next week, I want Sunday mornings, this is in my heart, I'll share what's in my heart, to be a celebration of all what God's done in and through us throughout the week. That we don't live, oh, the culmination of my Christian life is Sunday mornings. It's an exciting point. It's a high point. It's an equipping. It's a passion. We worship together. We hear God's word. We press in. You know, we try to focus. We go for it. We're ministering to kids. We're believing for families. We're stepping up. You guys are people of faith. That's why you're able to receive this message this morning, because you're already people of faith. You're already people that are there. Frankie is one of the most faithful people I've ever met in my entire freaking life. You're amazing. You too, Bill. You guys are amazing.
Yes.
Yeah.
You guys are all amazing. But she comes here every week. She's prepared a whole thing for 50 kids this morning. Why? God's preparing her heart for the increase. Let's all press in. Let's all be faithful. Let's all invite families out. If you have a gift of worship, we want you on this worship team. If you got whatever you've got, contribute it. Pray. Press in. Hear from the Lord. Tell me what's inside your heart. If I send something from you, I'll ask you, do you want to do this? And if you don't, that's cool too. But whatever, let's keep progressing. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
I want to see altars filled with sinners repenting. That's the heart of God. To see a movement. See people getting saved. Father, I just thank you for this morning. Thank you for your presence that's in this place. I pray right now, Lord, for a supernatural fire, just a boldness, a fresh fire, a fresh anointing on each one of our hearts, on our minds, Lord. Lord, make us willing. Amen. Where we're not willing, Lord, we're willing to be made willing. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your grace. Just say that with me. I'm willing.
I'm willing.
To be made willing.
To be made willing.
Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Sometimes if you're not willing, just be willing to be made willing.
Yeah.
God, come and change me. Come and change me. Thank you, Lord, for your word this morning. Help us go forward. Help us recognize the battle. Help us fight with the weapons of peace and love and trust in you. And help us advance by obeying your voice, Lord, by obeying the promptings of your spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Let's give Jesus a hand clap. He's amazing.